woke up this morning, sometime around 3 a.m. Dripping wet beads of sweat, rolling down my skin. Lately I can't sleep, I got hell on my mind. Running on empty, but Lord, I'm running dry, yeah. Sometimes temptation is just too much to bear. It's too much whiskey, girls with long dark hair. I know I should pay my tab and call a cab back home, but I hate to sleep alone. I hear them coming, trying to take my soul away. Making deals with the devil, now it's a time to pay. I keep on running, pray my heart don't take the blame. Can't take this devil off my back. Fight the good fight until the very end. Gonna climb that mountain with all of my friends. When I get to the top, I'll turn around and yell, devil, go back to hell. I hear them coming, trying to take my soul away. Making deals with the devil. So glad that you're joining us today. You're probably thinking, Michael, why are you singing that song? Well, let me tell you why. We're in a series called Branded, and we're talking about characteristics and character traits of a Christ follower. And so I don't know where you are today in your life. Maybe you're fully pursuing Jesus wholeheartedly, but maybe you're in a place today where you have questions about life and what's happening in life. And I want to read to you this passage today in Luke 9:23. This is actually coming out of the Passion Translation. And it says, Jesus said to all of his followers, if you are truly my disciple, you must disown your life completely and embrace my cross as your own and surrender to my ways. So as I said, I don't know where you are today, but as we go through this service today, as we go through our singing today, as we go through the message today, I want you to keep your heart open and your mind open, because many of us have this struggle of denying ourselves to follow Jesus. So I don't know where you are today, and our prayer today is that you will release that back to Christ today. And so we're grateful that you're joining us today. We're going to sing about our Lord and Savior. I'm going to invite you to stand, and let's sing together. Here we go. Let's sing this out. Sometimes you gotta dance through the darkness, sing through the fire, praise it when it all makes sense. Sometimes you gotta stand down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout.
praise you anywhere.
Yeah.
feeling lost or abandoned or feeling any doubt, I want to remind you that God remains so faithful. And His presence is right there with us, even if we can't sense it. And He meets us exactly right where we're at. So let's praise Him as we sing this next song and lift up our eyes to Him. The place. you're never leaving us, God. We love you. In your mighty and precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Can we celebrate that? Yes. Listen, if you haven't been to Grace the last 2 weekends, you have missed out, because that is only a glimpse of how amazing the last 2 weeks has been to see God move. And so, man, if you are new to Grace, welcome. My name's Chris. I'm the lead pastor here at Grace, and I'd love to connect with you. I would love for you to get connected here at Grace, and one of the easiest ways is through the QR code. In fact, the QR code has all of the best ways to connect and know what's going on here at Grace. So here's what I want to ask us all to do right now. If you'll take out your phone, go ahead and take it out and check the ringer on it. But whether you're new to Grace or you've been here in a while, I would encourage you to scan the QR code and see all that's going on, see all the ways to connect and all that's available to you through that resource. Now, on that video, you saw that last week we had 55 people go public with their faith through baptism. Yes. Now, here's what's crazy. I've heard multiple others, one at lunch this week, someone walked up to the table and said, hey, my friend was in that service, and he said, man, I was about to go get baptized, but I just didn't, but I'm signed up for the next one. So I'm excited. There was multiple others who said, man, I'm in, but I just couldn't step out, and they've signed up. If that's you, let me encourage you to join us. We're going to baptize again in just a couple of weeks. At the last weekend of April, you can sign up through the QR code, because we want to celebrate what God's doing in your life, and we want to just walk alongside you and encourage you as you take steps in your faith journey. Now, this spring, God has been doing some amazing things here, and I just want to share some of them with you. For one, you just saw the attendance at Easter. That is the largest attendance ever at Grace for a service. Not only that, this spring we've had 5 of the largest non-holiday weekend attendances just this spring. God is moving. Chad, one of our pastors, our finance pastor on staff, shared with me that our growth is over 35% year to date right now. Isn't that crazy? Now, here's the deal. Why do we share that? Because those people that God put us here to reach. Not only that, our kids ministry, the children's ministry is busting at the seams. Our student ministry has grown over 50% year over year. God is working. God is on the move. And on top of all that, we celebrate 55 baptisms last week, but that makes 85 baptisms just this year, 2024. So, listen, I'm so excited and grateful for God's grace. His grace is so good. And I'm so excited that I get to celebrate what God is doing. And I also want you to know that all of that is why we're expanding, right? Because God has put us here for a mission, and it's time to advance the mission by making more room for those that God has put us here to reach. And so I want to give you a quick update on what's going on, what's about to happen, all right, and what's coming up, because there's some changes, some big changes that are about to happen, all right? Just for clarity, because I've had lots of questions about what we're building, and we're not building a school, all right, and that's not what's going on. Listen, I've had so many people, I'm like, I never said school from the stage. Now I have, but it was with not in front of it, okay? All right, so So that being said, here's what phase one is, all right? Phase one is largely more kid space. That's you're looking at the new kid's wing from the outside. That's inside the kid space. It's going to have improved security. It's going to have a relocation of the kids ministry. It's more room. When we started this project back in 2021, we did some research. We had less than 35% of the recommended square footage per kid in that space. And now it's only grown since then. So we're excited that God is enabling us. He gave us the vision and the heart back then, and we're moving forward with this. Now, this is going to be built on the north side of the church, all right, which is where you currently park, okay, and where you enter. So you see the existing concrete lot. You come in from that side. That will no longer be the front entrance. You will now enter from the west side, which is like right behind me, okay? I know we did the whole direction thing the other day, and some people pointed up for north, so I'm just going to help you out, all right? West is where the new gravel lots have been added, and most people will begin parking in the gravel lots because that's where the parking is available. There will be handicap parking on the west side of the building, which is the other side of the building, the opposite side of the gravel lots, and we'll have a handicap parking entrance for those people parking on that side of the building as well, okay? So this is the phase that we're currently in. We hope to be finished by next year, Easter, around Easter, if all goes as planned. Y'all can pray for that. You know, if you've been around construction anytime, you know there's all sorts of things that can slow it down and delay it, and we're just praying against any of that, and that if anything, it speeds up and we get ahead of schedule. So you can pray with us on that. And then phase two is a larger auditorium. It's larger lobby space. It's with seating for people to gather on the weekends when they're here, and even to come and gather during the week and be able to use the space during the week for meetings and Bible studies and such. The start date of this is to be determined based on when we are in the right financial position to proceed, all right? When we started this project, you know, a couple years ago, we looked at it and said, we are not going to be able to right-size both spaces if we do it all at once. And it's more important that we have the right size space than to get it done quickly. And so we broke it into two phases. And we decided, man, taking care of the next generation is our priority. And then we're going to take care of this next phase next. And so that being said, that's what this phase process is for. And if God puts it on your heart to say, man, we got to get to phase two, I'll write a check. I will not stop you. All right? I will praise God for that. But here's the thing. Phase one has begun. And there are some major changes coming that's going to impact how you park and how you enter the building. So in a couple weeks, they're going to put up some construction fencing in that front parking lot to begin to do the dirt work that's necessary for the building. But that means that most people are going to park in the gravel lot, and then we'll have handicap parking on the other side. Now, you may be thinking, oh, man, that is going to be so fun, right? You're right. It's going to be so much fun because progress, while it may create a little pain, it is so exciting that we are moving forward with the vision that God has given us for this church. We get to celebrate something that God's doing that can only be explained by saying, look what God did. That's what we're celebrating, and we're excited about it. Now, here's what I'm asking us to do as we continue to journey forward. First of all, pray big, ask big, and believe big, because we have a big God. He is a God of abundance. He is not a God of scarcity. He has everything we need to move forward with his mission for his church. It's not our church, it's his, and he's going to build his church with or without us. I say let's get on board and get to be a part of what God's doing here. But here's the other deal. I know that many of you have made faith-filled commitments to our New Horizons initiative to help us advance the mission. I want to thank you for your faithfulness and your obedience to give back to God. My prayer is that God is blessing your obedience in your life right now. I do know that many are still checking out the church, the Grace thing, not sure where you are. And here's what I'd say. If you consider Grace your church, I want to invite you to make a commitment with us and journey with us. And you can do that through getting a commitment card at the hub or at the New Horizons space in the lobby or through the QR code. Now, here's why commitment matters is because we know this. We prioritize what we commit to. And I want you to ask God, how do you want this to be a priority in my life, to be a part of what you're doing, to build your church and to build your kingdom? and then just do whatever God tells you to do and be a part of what God is doing right here, this miracle in the cow pasture, as it's often been called. Now, one of the other things I want to ask is you continue to keep coming to this 8 o'clock service, all right? And invite others. Listen, the best seats are still here, all right? They're not in the 9 o'clock or 9:30 or 11. There's no good seats left in there, so don't go to those, all right? Come to this 8 o'clock or the 12:30, okay? You are the advanced class, all right? And then if you don't serve anywhere already, I'd love for you to consider joining us in our parking lot team or our first impressions team as we move into this next phase, because we are going to need more people to help us in those areas. Because listen, you're not just parking cars or serving coffee or saying hi to people. You are creating engaging experiences that helps people let down the walls and open up their eyes to what God has for them. So step into that space by sending out there and helping direct people and take the tension off, all right? You can help us. You can sign up today through the QR code. Listen, that's a lot. I just want to share with you because a lot of people have questions, but I want you to know I'm so excited about what God's doing, and I'm grateful that we get to see him do things that can only be explained by saying, God did it. It's not me. It's not you. It's what God's at work doing. There's a prayer, a verse I've been praying. I want to read to you, and I want us to pray it together over what God's doing here at Grace. It's Psalm 90, verse 16 through 17. It says, let us, your servants, see you work again. Let our children see your glory. Let the next generation see your glory, see you move. And may the Lord our God show us his approval and make our efforts successful. Yes, make our efforts successful. Listen, that's been my prayer. Psalm 90, verse 16 through 17. If you want to write that down and hold on to that, begin praying that with me. Because God's doing a work. We're asking him to continue to move and make our efforts successful as we follow him. Hey, I want to pray over this, and I want to pray over what God's doing. I also want to take a moment and just pray for what's going on in Israel right now. So, Father, we lift up what you're doing here at Grace, and we're grateful for the way you're moving, the way your Holy Spirit is working in people's lives as people are putting their faith in you and going public with your faith, God. It is a work of your Spirit, and it's a work of you, God. God, I ask that you would draw more people to yourself, and God, that you would move in our hearts to be a part of what you're doing, that we get to share in what you're doing here at Grace. I pray that you give us courage and boldness to just follow you in faith and do whatever you tell us to do. Now, God, I lift up what's going on in Israel, and just my heart is burdened for them and breaks for what's going on there. God, your word tells us God, pray for peace in Israel. And so that's what we're asking this morning, is that you bring peace to that Israel, to Israel and to that area. God, that you strengthen Israel, and that you protect the innocent. And God, ultimately, that you draw people to yourself, that eyes will be open to the Messiah, to Jesus as Lord and Savior. And God, that you would be glorified in and through it. God, give us the right response. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's a way of life. Day in, day out. It's felt when they walk in a room. It's seen in what they do. Heard in how they talk. It's the experience and the mark their lives make.
All right. Awesome. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, I don't know if you should. Hopefully, you're pretty excited about all the stuff that Pastor Chris was just sharing. Just my mind's all over the place thinking about that stuff and then thinking about what we're talking about today. But last week, we kicked off a series called Branded. And every time I watch that, I'm not the person that wants to go hop on a bull or something like that. But I do want to go watch somebody else do it, right? And so it gets me a little bit excited. I get excited about what we celebrated last week when we celebrated 55 people getting baptized, going public with their faith. Yeah, it was awesome. And when we kicked off the series, what we started talking about is that the whole reason we're talking about being like branded is we're talking about characteristics that would be evident in the life of someone who calls themselves a follower of Jesus. And Pastor Chris talked about the fact that baptism is one of those things. That when we choose to follow Jesus, then we then follow that up with an outward expression of an inward decision by getting baptized. And it shows, like we're telling people, I am a follower of Jesus. We talked about that when we think about a brand is something that's permanent. It's visible. It represents something larger. I looked up the word branded in the definition of it, and I found that the definition of that is marked to show ownership. I was like, oh, okay. That's pretty strong when you consider saying that I'm branded by being a follower of Jesus. So I place myself under the authority of who he is. And that's tough to talk about when we talk about some of these characteristics like the one that we're going to talk about today. Pastor Michael already mentioned it in the verse that he read, but it's to deny yourself. And so me and Chris, we were sitting down, he asked me to speak today, and we're looking through, and I'm asking him what the series, like what we're going through in all the series, and what things we're going to talk about, and he said, well, here's the characteristics that we're going to talk about, and baptism, and deny yourself, and then a couple of others, and I'm going, don't pick deny yourself for me. That one's not easy to talk about. And so here I am, talking about denying ourselves, and I just, like, I don't know about you, but that's not something that I am good at. It's not something that it comes naturally. It's something that my parents would tell you that I was a very strong-willed child, and I want to do things my way all the time, and I still act like that as an adult. And so looking at this, I was like, whew, okay, here we go. Now, we also talked about this idea of, like, writing for the brand. Like that, when you think about that, maybe for you, you think of rodeo, or you might think of a sports team. It could be like your job or your company. It could even be your family. Like maybe you have a family crest, or I have some friends that every single person in their family, even the ones that marry in, they all have the exact same tattoo. Like they ride for the brand in that family. Maybe for you, it's patriotism, or you were in a fraternity or a sorority or a motorcycle club that you ride with. And as I started thinking through all of those things, they all have an aspect of that. But you know the unique thing about being a follower of Jesus? When you look at it in terms of being branded, it's the only brand that is more for you than you are for it. He cares more about us and what our relationship with him looks like than what anything that we're ever going to do for him. And so as we look at that, when I'm trying to talk about denying ourselves, I think that that plays into why we're able to do it. I also love the fact that as a follower of Jesus, I don't get retired because I get too old. I don't get replaced because somebody younger or better than me comes along. The kingdom of God does not need me at all, yet invites me to be a part of it anyways. It's actually the very reason that I was created, that you were created. We were all created for a relationship with God. He's like, I want you to be in relationship with me. And as we choose to follow Jesus, he calls us to something more and more as we develop that relationship with him. He did that with his disciples. In fact, he caught them off guard all the time by statements that he made. And many times he would say something, and I think, like, I place myself in Scripture when I'm reading that, and it's like he says something, and they're like, wait, hold on, what did you say? But this time, when you look at the piece of Scripture that we're going to look at today, he actually stopped and got their attention. If you study this passage, the language that it uses basically says that he made sure that he had everybody's attention when he made this statement. And it's the same verse that Pastor Michael read earlier. It's Luke 9:23, and here's what it said. Jesus said to all of his followers, if you truly desire to be my disciple, you must disown your life completely. Now, if I'm one of the disciples, again, I put myself there. I'm like, wait, what? Disown my life completely? Like, totally? And they've got to be thinking, like, maybe about themselves or maybe about the person around. I'm like, Peter, stop always doing the crazy stuff, bro. Or, hey, stop picking on your brother, James. Or whatever it looked like. Like, deny yourself. God, they had to be thinking, what does that mean? And then he takes it a step further and he says, embrace my cross as your own. And for us, the cross is a picture of hope and what Jesus did for us. But for them, he hadn't died on the cross, let alone rose again at that time. The cross was a picture of something that was used for torture and to kill people. And it was a horror, like a cross. Don't ask me to take up a cross. That means to die. What do you mean? And he says, and surrender to my ways. And I think, with that strong language, the disciples were going, what is he talking about? I would have been going, I don't know what you mean here. When I first started thinking through this, I thought, you know, I've read this passage a bunch of times, and I gloss over it saying, yeah, okay, God, what you want me to do is to do things your way instead of my way, and that's a constant battle, and I don't always get it right, and I'm going to try to do that, and I'm going to try to do better. But as I started looking at it, it's so much stronger than that. I was like, man, I get this wrong. Like I said, I was a strong-willed child. Not only that, when I graduated college, I lived on my own for 15 years before I got married. I got to do what I wanted, when I wanted. Nobody could tell me how to spend my money. It didn't matter. If I went to, I had responsibilities for work. But when I got home, I answered to me. And when you do that for a long time, you get really selfish. My wife will tell you that I'm really selfish when it comes to, don't interrupt my sleep. Like, I get mad if she wakes me up. And different things like that. And so, I struggle with the me, that I want my way all the time. And so I'm like, God, are you sure you want me to talk about this? And then I looked at that word, in some passages it says to deny yourself, where it says disown your life completely. Oh, another translation of that was even more powerful. It said to utterly refuse to recognize the original source involved. It's like, okay, God, I don't understand exactly what you're saying here. Because, you know, when I think of deny yourself, we think of some of the easy things, maybe. I'm just not going to have extra dessert. Or not, maybe I'm going to give up dessert this, for right now. Or maybe for you, you think of, I'm giving this up for Lent, even if you're not Catholic or even really know what that means, right? We think of those things as denying ourselves. Or I'm going to give up something that I enjoy doing for this time period because I'm trying to do things a little bit different. But to utterly and completely disregard the original the original source involved. And I had to go, okay, God, I need you to help me understand what you mean. And here's the thing. You're going to hopefully be able to track, because I'm going to give you a picture of what goes on in my brain whenever I start looking at these things and trying to understand them. And I think in pictures. And I'm also very literal. So I'm like, deny myself completely doesn't completely make sense to me because you made me. And then I started thinking about, I had all these pictures, and, the easiest thing to think about is social media, all this stuff that goes on and things that people say, and this is completely counter to culture. right? Because the message that you get, that your kids get, the students get, that you see on social media all the time is follow your heart. This is my truth. Hey, if it makes you happy, it can't be that bad. You only live once, or YOLO. Hey, do whatever makes you feel good. Hey, if it's not hurting anybody else, it's fine. And we make decisions based on what we want all the time. Confession, I bought a truck. Now, it's been a while. It's been like my truck's 9 years old. I love my truck. But when I bought that truck, I didn't ask God if that was a good decision. I found a truck that I wanted. I could afford to do it. And I bought me a truck, and I was excited about it. We do that with, like, everything. Do you consult God with big decisions, small decisions? I'll tell you what. There's a lot of times that I don't even take what he wants into consideration. I just get up and seek out the things that I want. And I see stuff like that all over social media, things people post. Like, I got this new car. They don't say that I can't afford, but I'm blessed. Or I know people that bought a house because it's just, this is the house that I've always wanted, and I'm never going to have another opportunity like this. And a couple of years later, they couldn't afford it, and they're foreclosed on because taxes went up or whatever. And how many life decisions do we make based on what we want and never even allow God to enter the picture? So I'm like, God, how do you want me to die to myself? I don't really understand what you want this to look like. And here's what happened. This picture popped in my mind, and I'm typing stuff out, and I'm talking to God, and I'm reading, and I'm looking at stuff. And the picture have you ever seen those videos where it shows like a conversation between two people? And people are way more creative than I am, and they can do that. I have no idea. I would have loved to have made this to show you, but it shows like the text message, like, hey, this is what's happening. And then bing, and then here's the response. No, that's not what I said. Bing, and it's this back and forth, and you kind of laugh, and it's a funny video. That's what happened in my brain when I was talking to God about this. And so here's what I said. I said, hey, God, more than anything, I think I struggle with this. I struggle with the self-centered part of me that wants all the things that I want, and then everything else around me in life try to change or adjust or challenge the things that I want, and then it feels like we're in conflict. Bing! God says, yep, exactly. Cool, thanks. Thanks for that, God. Cool. I said, but here's what I don't get, like, because I read scripture, right, and I know what you've said about me, and I start just sending these things, like, boom, here's this one. Hey, you created me. You made me in your image with a purpose, for a reason. You uniquely, I am uniquely and wonderfully made. You knit me together in my mother's womb. You even like the me that you created. You had me in mind when you formed the earth. Bing! Yep, exactly. What do you mean? Deny myself completely? Like, utterly forget that? I'm supposed to do that? Bing! Yes. How? Bing! I'm glad you asked. Took me to some different things that I read and some things that I watched. And it was like, in my head, it was like, here's a link, watch this. Here's a link, read this. And here's where I landed and what I feel like he shared with me to say to you today is that God made me and you in his image. But see, Adam sinned. Adam, when he sinned, he got separated from God. And because of that sin, that image that he created Adam in got twisted and perverted and distorted. In that separation, Adam became self-centered, self-focused, self-defending, self-justified, self-driven. And he didn't just sin, but he became a God unto himself, and he took on the very nature of the one who deceived him and Eve. And he went from the image of God to being a self-centered, self-centered being that when you looked at no longer had a reflection of God, but a distorted view of what the image of God is supposed to look like in our lives. And the problem is that you and I were born into that. And it is ugly. You do not have to teach a child how to be selfish. It is natural. And when we live in that and we believe all the things that people say around us and what culture teaches us, wow, will we just go that self-centered direction? The writer of Proverbs said that there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it just leads to death. And I think that's a picture of what happens when we don't put ourselves under the authority of who Jesus is, when we accept him as our Savior and choose to follow him. Because that's just where it starts. I choose to follow Jesus. Hopefully after that, I get baptized. But that whole follow takes action and self-denial. And I'm sitting here talking to God going, what does that look like? Bing. Now go read Luke again. Okay, God, let's do that. So I go back. Go back to Luke 9:23. You're there. I'm sorry. Jesus said to all of his followers, if you truly desire to be my disciple, you must disown your life completely. Okay, I'm beginning to understand what that looks like. Embrace my cross as your own. I don't like that statement. And surrender to my ways. Okay. And then he says, keep reading. For if you choose self-sacrifice, giving up your lives for my glory, you will discover true life. Wait a minute. So then I give up that old version of me, that distorted version of me. I completely forget that, the self-centeredness of me, and you restore me to a reflection of you. That's true life. That's what I need to get. But I don't necessarily know how to do that. Keep reading. Oh, okay. He says, but if you choose to keep your lives for yourself, you will lose what you try to keep. And this picture popped into my head of being close-fisted. I read a book years ago by a guy named Bob Goff, and he talked about how what we do is we hold on and we keep our fists closed all the time, trying to hold on and control all the things around us. And I don't know about you, but that's a real accurate picture of me. We don't want to let go because when we open our hands, what happens is we begin to feel vulnerable. And I don't like feeling vulnerable. And you keep going, and it says, even if you gained all the wealth and power of this world and all the things it could offer you, yet lost your soul in the process, what good is that? So I felt like at that point, God's going, yeah. See, stop believing all the things that everybody else tells you, to seek out your way, to do things how you want. Quit trying to control all the things around you. Quit believing the fact, or quit believing what life has taught you, is that when you give up your way and you defer to other people, that you're just going to get walked on. That's always like in my head, like, that's why I don't do it. God, I'm just going to get trampled on. I don't want to be trampled on. He goes, but are you willing to choose to stay locked up, bound, and shackled by the things that you're holding on to, when I've told you time and time again that really you're free? You just gotta let all that stuff go. You see, being self-centered binds us and makes us stay trapped. And now anybody can rub you the wrong way if they don't fit your desires or your expectations, because all you care about is you. And I'm not, like, that's a little bit of an extreme, there are plenty of us that try to like help other people, do things for other people, like go out of our way sometimes to do that. But the reality is that you wake up in the morning thinking about yourself and you go to bed thinking about yourself 90% of the time, if not 100% of the time. I do. And he's like, forget being all about you, because when I do that, my preferences become Lord instead of Jesus. Self-centeredness is the reason for every argument that I'm in, and you too. Every discouragement, every offense, every unforgiveness. And Jesus is saying that, yes, that right there. That is what you need to utterly refuse to recognize, because that is not who you are. That's distorted. You're a reflection of your Creator. But you can't receive that as long as you're holding on to all the things that you want for yourself and not submitting to my authority. And here's what's beautiful, but yet so, so hard to do. It's to let go. And when you put yourself in a position like that, open-handed, God recently told me when we were going through the Uncharted stuff that what he wanted from me is through this whole process to be open-handed. I'm like, God, that's vulnerable. And I thought it just had to do with giving until this week. Cool, thanks, God. Open-handed, vulnerable. But you know what's beautiful about that? It's also a position to receive. And now I can go, what do you say about me, God? What do you want from me? How do you want me to live? And in what you pour into me, I can live out and be an example of who you are and who you created me to be, a reflection instead of a distortion. And as he calls us closer and closer to him and we become more and more like him, giving up that, we become less and less of what the world says about us, what our family or our experiences may have said about us, our environment, our culture, and what the enemy has taught us about ourselves. And you fast forward after the disciples have spent even more time with Jesus. He's constantly trying to help them understand what this looks like. And it's real, like there's not much time after this before he is crucified. And he's telling them about how to live. And here's what he says. We fast forward to Luke 22. And it says, the disciples were bickering over which one of them would be considered the greatest in the kingdom, because they thought Jesus was going to kick the Romans out and take over. And they're like, well, I'm going to be in charge of this, and I'm going to be in charge of this. And they didn't understand. So Jesus interrupted their argument. And here's what he said. He said, the kings and men of authority in this world rule oppressively over their subjects, claiming that they do it for the good of the people. They are obsessed with how others see them, but this is not your calling. You will lead by a different model. The greatest one among you will live as one called to serve others without honor, without recognition, without being praised for it. Like, you're going to do it because of who you are and who I am, not because of anything else. The greatest honor and authority is reserved for the one who has a servant heart. He says, the leaders who are served are the most important in your eyes and in the eyes of the world. But in the kingdom, it is the servants who lead. Am I not here with you as one who serves? See, everybody else looks at what's best for them. As the king, my rights, my thing, and I say that it's for other people, but that king, that picture that he said, is closed-fisted, trying to hold on to all of the power and all the things that he wants for himself. But Jesus set the ultimate example for us to follow, is to serve. And the more we become like Jesus and submit to his authority, the more we empty ourselves. And as a Christ follower, one of the characteristics that should be evident in each of our lives is to value others more than ourselves. And we start to do that by denying the self-centered part of us and looking to God for the truth of who He created us to be. Like I said before, a reflection of Him, where I discover my true identity, not the distortion that is just messed up because of sin. There's a guy that I follow that I listen to and have learned a lot from, and he makes this statement. He says that in our true identity, that we are self-emptying and others-focused. And I use that as a measuring tool in my own life. Like, am I operating in the identity of who God calls me and what He calls me to be? Am I self-emptying and others-focused? And many times I'm not. And it's a gauge for me to go, okay, God, what does that need to look like? What am I believing that's not true? And what do I need to give up to You to be able to receive back from You so that I can operate the way that You want me to? And there's a guy that wrote most of the New Testament. He wrote many letters after we read the Gospels that tell about Jesus' life. Most of the rest of that is written by a guy named Paul. And Paul, if you don't know who he is, he's a guy who hated Christians, hated Jesus, didn't want to have anything to do with that, and actually tried to spend a lot of his time stopping people from following Jesus until he met Jesus. And he was radically changed. And he spent the rest of his life trying to tell people who Jesus is and why we need to follow Him. And he wrote a letter to a church that he helped start in a place called Philippi. It's the book of Philippians that you can find in the New Testament. And I think that what he says here is a beautiful picture of what we're talking about today. We're going to look at it. I'm going to read it. You can follow along on the screen, but I'm going to read it from right here. But it's Philippians 2, and it's from The Message, and here's what it says. He said, if you've gotten anything at all out of following Christ, if His love has made any difference in your life, if being in a community of the Spirit means anything to you, if you have a heart, if you care, then do me a favor. Agree with each other. Love each other. Be deep-spirited friends. Don't push your way to the front. Don't sweet-talk your way to the top. Put yourself aside and help others get ahead. Don't be obsessed with getting your own advantage. Forget yourselves long enough to lend a helping hand. Think of yourselves the way that Christ Jesus thought of Himself. See, He had equal status with God, but didn't think so much of Himself that He had to cling to the advantages of that status no matter what. Not at all. When the time came, He set aside the privileges of deity and took on the status of a slave, became human. Having become human, He stayed human. It was an incredibly humbling process. He didn't claim special privileges. Instead, He lived a selfless, obedient life and died a selfless, obedient death. And the worst kind of death at that, a crucifixion. And because of that obedience, God lifted Him high and honored Him far beyond anyone or anything ever, so that all created things in heaven and on earth, even those long ago dead and buried, will bow and worship before Jesus Christ and call out in praise that He is the master of all, to the glorious honor of God the Father. He set an example that I don't think that I am capable of following, but He calls me to try. And maybe for you today, what that looks like is going, God, I'm tired of doing things my own way. It's not working out. I want to do things Your way. And you've never put your faith in Jesus and say, I want to accept what You did on the cross, and I want that to count for me. You can do that today. It's not a magic prayer. You can just tell Him, I want what You did to count for me. I want to begin to do things Your way and choose to follow You. You don't have to get it all right at the beginning. It's a start. It's a process. And if you want to talk to somebody about that, you can come to the hub after, or prayer partners will be here at the front. Maybe for you, you chose to follow Jesus a long time ago, but you battle like I do trying to do things Your way. That self-centeredness that you just keep trying to hold on to. Maybe today what you need to do is go, God, I don't necessarily know how to do this, but I want to submit. I want to finally like just go, okay, I'm in to give up that old me and accept what you have said about me. Maybe you need to take on the position of being vulnerable and let go and confess the things that you've been believing to be true that you think is what is happening all around you. And maybe you feel like a victim, or maybe like you feel like you have no control. And maybe that's just because you're trying to control everything. And here's what I'd ask you to do. I'm going to pray. And this may be uncomfortable for you. It's uncomfortable for me, but I try to put it into practice on a regular basis. Right where you are, open your hands. You don't have to say what I'm saying, but when you talk to God, this is not natural. It doesn't feel natural, but it's real hard to get angry and frustrated and demand my own thing. Like, try to say, I demand without closing here. It's hard, right? But when we take the physical position of being open-handed, it helps to put our heart in the same position as we go, God, I want to give up my way and receive from you what you want for me. So God, I don't know how to deny myself completely. I don't. But I want to be a reflection of you. And I don't get it right all the time. And you have ultimate patience and love and grace for me. And you keep calling me to more and more, to be more like you. And so I say, here, take it. And will you tell me what you think about me? What you believe about me? What you know? And help me to be a reflection of you and not a distortion. Help me to give up all the things that I feel like may even be owed to me and receive from you, so that that picture on my life reflects Jesus. And when people see that, they'll say, yep, that one's branded. That's a follower of Christ. I love you. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jeremy. What a powerful, powerful message. We're so grateful to each and every one of you for being here today. Don't forget, baptism's coming at the end of the month on April 28th. Also, as Pastor Chris mentioned, you can find everything about what's happening at Grace Fellowship through the QR code. Next Gen Gathering is next Saturday. That's for any leaders, anyone in leadership, ministry leadership in preschool, age group ministry, student ministry. We'd love for you to be a part of that if that's something you're interested in. We hope you have an incredible week. Our prayer partner is going to be down at the front. They'd love to pray with you. God bless you. We'll see you next Sunday.